The previous chapter we saw in detail how an NPN transistor works and how is it that semiconductors interact with each other to allow the passage of electrons under some conditions. Now, having that base, we'll see how other types of transistors work, and for this, I prepared this little genealogical tree that will guide us. If you want to see one of them specifically, here I leave the exact moment of the video in which it will appear, but obviously I recommend you follow the path that I prepared, because that way you will understand better the relationship between each of them. And before I start, I want to make some clarifications to avoid confusion later. First, if you live to the extreme and you didn't watch the first video, generally speaking, a transistor is a three-terminal electronic component, in which between the first and second terminal tries to flow an electric current. While in the third terminal, by modifying some variable, current is controlled acting like a switch or a signal amplifier. Secondly, I want to make a difference between the type of transistor, that is the relationship between its internal components, and the encapsulation or housing that protects it, since the same package can serve for several different types of transistors. So for example, at a glance we might know this is a TO3 package, a TO39, and a TO220, but we could not know if they are an NPN, PNP, MOSFET or whatever. Although on the other hand we could deduce that the larger or better heat dissipation options the package deliver, probably the transistor inside will be able to work with higher voltages or currents because the heat of a transistor is generated by the Joule effect, which, as we saw in the chapter on resistors, is related to these two variables. And thirdly, that the disposition of the internal elements of each transistor that I am going to show you will be only referential, because in reality they can have shapes a lot more complex, but the interaction between the elements should be the same or very similar. The first family of transistors of the which we will talk about are the bipolar joint transistors, or BJT for its acronym in English, and the first type of transistor of this family are the NPN transistors, that as we saw in the previous chapter, are composed of three interconnected semiconductors with different doping. The type N semiconductors have more free electrons, while P-type semiconductors have holes, or lack of electrons. Both electrons and holes, we will call them charge carriers, since they can move through the semiconductor allowing current flow. And what happens when we create a PN junction is that electrons can only move in one direction from the semiconductor type N to type P, when the positive pole of a voltage source is positioned in the semiconductor type P and the negative pole to the opposite side. Basically, this is how a diode works, and for those who have followed the other videos of the channel, sorry for explaining it for the third time, but this time I want to go deep into something that I did not give much importance in the previous videos, the depletion zone, or also known as depletion layer, which is precisely the area in which both semiconductors come into contact, since the wall of the N-type semiconductor will have electrons to spare and the wall of the semiconductor type P will have holes where electrons are missing. These will interact naturally to stay in balance, and therefore the charge carriers, that were previously free, will no longer be. This being the reason that it is known as a depletion region, and also that there is a potential barrier or a voltage threshold that must be exceeded for electrons to start to crossing it. That is not all, as that depletion zone can be overcome by having a direct polarization PN junction. It can also increase its size in reverse polarization. For a diode, it just means that electrons cannot flow, but, as we will see later, this same principle can be useful as a control method in a transistor. Returning to our NPN bipolar junction transistor, this will form two merged PN junctions, with a total of three terminals or electrodes: the collector, the emitter, and finally the base. The grace of this mix of components is that by varying the current that passes between the emitter and the base, we can control whether or not the current passes between the collector and the emitter, being able to act as a switch or signal amplifier. Now, what happens if we change the doping of semiconductors? We would have a PNP bipolar junction transistor which roughly works just like the NPN, but there are two big differences. The first is that the required voltage between the base and the emitter in a PNP transistor must go in the reverse direction to that of the NPN transistor, which is quite useful if we want to amplify an alternating signal, because using both types we could amplify both positive and negative voltage. The second difference is that since the electrons can move faster through a semiconductor than the holes, an NPN transistor, which mostly it is composed of semiconductors type N and therefore has more electrons, will have a shorter reaction time, being more useful for situations that require working with high-frequency signals. The third transistor I want to talk about is based on bipolar junction transistors and has a fairly simple principle. We know that a transistor can amplify a signal, so what would happen if we amplified that signal that was already amplified? Exactly, that is the foundation behind a Darlington pair. Basically, they are two bipolar junction transistors connected in series. The truth here is that there is not much to explain. What is interesting is that despite being two transistors together, the amount of electrodes is still three, which means that once encapsulated we will have a transistor that works exactly like the previous ones, but with greater potential amplification or gain. The fourth type of transistor is a phototransistor, that as you can imagine allows to control the flow of current depending on the light that comes to it. The way a phototransistor works is adding to a bipolar junction transistor a new element, a photodiode, which varies its resistance to the passage of the current in reverse polarization depending on the light that falls on it. By working together, when the photodiode receives light, allows to flow a part of the current from the collector to the base, that is, it will be amplifying itself depending on the light. If we analyze the phototransistor and the photodiode, we will realize that they do the same. The light comes to them and they let current through, but the reason because a photodiode is not used directly, is that the current that lets pass is so low that an amplifier is required to get useful results. Now for the fifth type, let's go to the other branch of our family tree of transistors. The following transistors are known as field effect transistors or FET, and the first one, which would be the fifth of our list, is the JFET, or joint field effect transistor. This also works using semiconductors type N and type P, but they are arranged in a different way. In this case, there is a channel made of a single semiconductor between two terminals, which we will call source and drain. As I mentioned in the previous video, a doped semiconductor can transmit the current without problems, and therefore, so far, all we have is a simple cable. But the interesting thing happens when we add a semiconductor of the opposite type in the middle of the canal, as in the bipolar junction transistors. This new element is known as the gate. What will happen is that since they form new PN junctions, the corresponding depletion zone will also be created. In principle, even without applying any voltage on the gate, if the electrons want to flow from the source to the drain, these will not have problems. However, the higher the voltage between the source and the drain, this depletion zone will begin to change its shape, following the same logic we saw in the diode. Therefore, the higher the voltage, the greater the depletion zone in which there are no free charge carriers. Which finally means that our channel that previously allowed electrons to pass freely, now it is much narrower, and therefore will limit the current that passes between the source and the drain. So if we made a current versus voltage curve, the result would be something like this. And now you are surely asking, so what does the gate do? In the JFET, the gate is used to further increase the depletion zone, and therefore generate a strangulation of the current flow, modifying the curve of current versus voltage gradually until it completely closes the passage of electrons. This type of transistor is usually called by the type of semiconductor that makes up the channel, so this would be a JFET of N channel and this one of P channel, being the main difference the voltage that must be applied to the gate. The idea is that an inverse polarization is generated at the PN junction. And since the PN union is reversed, so does the required voltage. So technically we go in the fifth and sixth type of transistor. And now finally the one that was probably the most requested transistor from you, the MOSFET or metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, which refers to the materials used in its construction. Although they may currently be composed of other materials. Let's start by reviewing the components that are between the source and the drain. We will find a channel composed of a doped semiconductor, let's say, type N, but right where the electrodes will be connected we will change the type of semiconductor. So we would have something similar to a PNP transistor, but instead of the middle type N semiconductor being extremely thin, now the proportions will be reversed. Again, since we will have two petanewtons junctions, the corresponding depletion zones will form, avoiding the passage of the current in its natural state. And this is where the MOS of MOSFET appears to save the day as a control system. First, the channel will be our semiconductor. To this we add an oxide layer, although in reality what we need is a dielectric material that prevents the passage of electrons. And finally, the metal will be our electrode, or basically a conductive element, which by the way corresponds to our gate. Probably, if you saw my video about capacitors, this configuration will be familiar. If we remember a little, a capacitor was composed of a conductor, a dielectric and a conductor. In this case we have a conductor, a dielectric and a semiconductor doped with surplus electrons, and therefore when applying negative voltage on the gate, electrons will gather on the side of the dielectric, but without crossing to the other side, repelling the electrons of the channel. Since equal charges repel each other and attracting the positively charged carriers that were in the P-type semiconductor to the edge fired in the gate, but this does not imply a movement of electrons unlike the base of the BJT where this happened. And why is this an advantage? Well, since the BJT require current to change the transistor states, these generate extra heat that must be dissipated, which limits the number of transistors that can be put on a chip maintaining a reasonable cooling system. This reason and the fact that the MOSFET does not let the current pass between the source and the drain, make the latter extremely popular in the manufacture of electronic devices. With that, we already have 8 types of transistors. That is because a MOSFET can have an N-channel, but also a P-channel. Now we only have 2 types of transistors. So let's move on to the next. This monster, an IGBT, or insulated gate bipolar transistor. It may seem complicated, but if we analyze it in parts we will realize that it's just the mix between a BJT and a MOSFET. But it's not a regular mix, they are ordered in a very similar way to a Darlington pair. Thanks to that, the IGBT has a high gain and can be controlled by voltage like the FET. Do you still not see it? In this example the distribution of the elements and its behavior is symmetric. So, for the moment, we are going to ignore half of the transistor to simplify it. In the upper corner we will have a small P-channel MOSFET, while on the side we will have something similar to a PNP BJT. There are different types of IGBT and its operation has several details that I will not explain in this video, and probably never. But in a very simplified way, what happens is that by having a voltage at the gate, that is to say, in the MOSFET, we will allow the passage of the current towards the base of the PNP, which also will allow the passage of the current directly from the emitter to the collector. Although not following the shortest path between them, but slightly replicating the trajectory from the MOSFET to the collector. With that we have 9 types of transistors, and if you thought this can't be more confusing, we still have the last type of transistor that I will explain, quantum transistors, but they deserve an in-depth explanation, so we will leave it for the next chapter, with which I will close this mini-series on transistors. If you don't want to miss it, subscribe and activate notifications. That's all for now and see you in the next chapter.